when I was a young reporter, a young woman, going to Gaza or Sarajevo or Somalia or Rwanda, it was, in a sense, it was much more dangerous, but it was much more simple. I would report, I would speak to people, I would write my report, I would file it, and that was it. We now live in a time of social media, and you once said something that social media has disrupted our sense of time. But I think in many ways, social media has disrupted everything.
Newspapers used to give us a sense of the world and our place in it. Me, national news, international news, yeah? They constructed a sense of time. Every day the newspaper is new. It gives you today's news, tomorrow's. They sit in the corner yellowing, giving you a sense of chronology. So they gave you a space of space, your place in the world, and of time. And on social media, I guess this is what was driving me nuts. That was breaking down because, you know, news comes at you from a week ago or 2 days ago. Then a memory comes at you. You know, it's more like, and your sense of space. So your sense of time is broken. Then your sense of space is broken because it's all around you. Space becomes stuff that you like. It's, you just see sort of bits of your own reflection in the water. So it's completely warped our sense of self, space and time. And I just found that really, really unpleasant. And I started to get nostalgic about the sense of space and time that the newspaper would give me. I don't know if that's the future. I don't know if my kids are gonna do that. I'm trying to encourage them. I don't know if they are now living in this soup, this liquid thing where, you know, news is inside of them and outside of them, and they're posting videos about themselves all the time. I'm very aware that something fundamental has shifted in their sense of space, time and the self. And I'm watching them, observing them, and I'm not sure where it's going to end up. We don't know when we see something online, who put it there? How much did they spend? Why are we seeing this thing and not another thing? Why is this piece of information being targeted at me? Which of my own data is being used? We don't see it. We're like Caliban on Prospero's Island, surrounded by this info noise and these weird spells. And that has to change. You should look, when you're online in the soup, you should understand, why is that information there? Who's behind it? How much did they spend? Why is it being targeted at me? And then at least we can start to think in ways that are steeped in old democratic values. You can start critiquing it. You can start thinking, oh, how interesting. It's not just there. It's not just a soup. Somebody has put ingredients in this soup.
How do people, ordinary people, get the real story? How do we know what's true and what's not true?
Pluralism now tips over into hyper-partisanship, which is so vicious, the sort of the space for a common democratic public debate breaks down. People slide off into very, very angry identities, which are then further fueled by the emotional logic of social media. Freedom of expression. Now, I'm certainly not saying we should get rid of freedom of expression, but it's been hacked as an idea, simply because today's, you know, dictators or illiberal populists or extremists, they don't try to censor people necessarily. They overload the information space with troll armies and cyber militias and disinformation campaigns, which often stop short of full-on kind of extremist hate speech.
You said there's a lot of information out there. We should use all that information, but how do we know what's true? How do we know what's just? How do we know what we should be reading, actually?
So I would put it much more to the responsibility of the journalists, because people are going to get lost and they will, you know, they will reach for stuff which they find either confirms their biases. And by the way, even very educated people do that. That's not, you know, we've seen that over and over, or they'll reach for something which just feels genuine. Something I've heard from the Donbass to New Jersey and all the time in the Middle East is like, yeah, I don't know what's true, what's not, but I'm going to go with what, you know, what I feel is right. And then obviously sort of like, you know, genuineness and being genuine rather than truthful becomes more important. I think we might need some sort of like part of journalism or some sort of blend of civil society and journalism that gets up in the morning thinking about this, not as communication specialists, yeah, not as stratcoms people, but as journalists, as media, whose aim is to dredge up society's traumas and get society to discuss them. You know, it's not about sort of finding commonalities, you know, and, you know, being touchy-feely and all that stuff. No, it's about like, how do we talk about pulling down Robert E. Lee statues, but in a way that actually engages the side that has a problem with it?